Good evening, everybody. Good evening and welcome. Well done for turning out on this rather damp December evening for this full council meeting, Frome Town Council. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Toby. I'm the Mayor of Frome and also the Chairman of the Council. Before we make a start, I've got three quick announcements. The first is that as a bit of an experiment tonight, we're filming this meeting. Thanks to Rupert and his team for that. We're not streaming live, but we're thinking that might be a possibility in the future. But it's so that there's a record of the meeting for those who weren't able to attend tonight. And at some point in the future, we'll have a version of it up on a website somewhere. However, if you really don't want to be filmed, there's almost nothing we can do to ensure that you won't be. So now is your chance to head for the door. Secondly, if you haven't been to a town council meeting for a while, or in fact this is your first time, then we're doing things slightly differently. So you'll see there isn't a big bank of councillors and the public beyond facing each other. What we're doing is we're trying to get you all together and engaged in a more useful conversation, and there will be a point fairly near the beginning of the meeting where we're going to ask you to do some specific discussions. There should be at least one town councillor on every table. They will be identified by having a voting card, sort of like this, with their name on it. Can town councillors hold up their voting cards? Thank you very much. So those serve two purposes. Firstly, you can tell who's who, and secondly, you can see who votes which way at any point. There are two things that we need to remember. So councillors need to remember to keep an open mind at all times, and everybody needs to remember that councillors are not required to vote with the room or with their table at any particular point. And then finally, tonight we've got a fairly full agenda. It doesn't necessarily look that long, but the subject's quite meaty. So although there's nothing that I enjoy more than controlling this meeting for hours on end, I feel that maybe some of you wouldn't share that. So there will be times when I'm moving us on, so please accept that will be the case. Okay, so I'm going to make a start. Paul, apologies for absence.
Yes, we've got apologies from Kath Puddick, Heather Ride, Ali Barkley, and Gary Collinson is going to try and get here to Paris even this evening, so maybe.
Okay, thank you. And minutes from the last meeting. Are there any questions or comments on the minutes from meeting last time on the 21st of September?
We have an update on the sale of Port Street toilets.
Yes, Peter Wheelhouse is closest to that one, who's behind you, Pippa.
So this is a sale by Mendip on Cork Street toilet block.
Okay, just to confirm, unfortunately, the District Council actually withdrew the toilet block, the former toilet block, from their auction due to take place. In fact, we had the news only a day after we had the debate at that meeting. I'm trying to find out at the moment what's happening. I'm trying to arrange a meeting with Keith Pennyfather, who is the asset manager for the District Council, to find out what's going to happen in the future. I'll keep you posted.
Thank you, Peter. Anybody else on the minutes from last time? No? Then can I have a proposal for the minutes, please? Nothing else? Okay, can I have a proposal for minutes? Pippa and a seconder, Kate. Thank you. And all those in favour, accepting the minutes? Any against? And any abstentions? Okay, unanimous. Thank you. I'll sign them in a second. Okay, so before we get into the meeting proper, are there any questions or comments from members of the public? If you have a question or comment on something that appears on the agenda later on, save it for then, and we'll try and bring you in at that point. So is there anything not on the agenda? Yes, at the back. Can we get a microphone?
Yeah. on the fittings all round. And just outside the bridge is a telegraph pole with a wire, electric wire. There's about 30 or 40 pigeons sit there all day long. Now, it was all very well putting the spikes up, but the pavement underneath has not been cleaned. I know there's no feathers in everything else showing, but all the droppings have been left on the pavement. When it gets wet, it's all slippery and sludgy, and I would have thought that putting the spikes up and doing all that, the pavement would have been cleaned, scraped with all the droppings off and cleaned and brushed down, but it's all been left, and that hasn't been done.
Colin, you've been dealing with this. Okay, so we'll pass on the comment about the pavement to the landscape group and make sure that in their next round that's what they do. Okay, anybody else? Yes, Tracy. Comments from councillors, district, town, county otherwise? Rich?
Yeah. This is from Chris Stringer, Environment Manager, and it's about Friday night lighting, Christmas lights. Firstly, I'd like to formally say thank you to Mendip District Council and to their staff for arranging all of the licences and permissions for Friday's Switch On event and for waiving the fee for this year's Christmas tree. Secondly, I'd like to thank ID Verdi's team on the ground on Friday night. That's the new name for the landscape group, if you're not aware. And although the cleanup during and after Frome's Christmas event is part of ID's main contract with MDC, the team took real pride in helping keep the town centre clean and tidy all night, starting well before the event and working through into the night. So a special thanks to Jordan, Ken, Martin, Sean, Terry and Todd. The event wouldn't have been the success it was without your efforts. Again, that's from Chris Stringer.
Thanks, Rich. Anyone else?
You can do it in post.
With the success of the Frome Independent, it brought heavy visit congestion along certain areas of Frome. The other day, as I was walking along the Glasgow, and there was heavy congestion all the way to Wallbridge, back as far as Gorehedge. I assume this is busy with traffic trying to access, visit the Park and Rides, visit the Frome Hospital and visit the school. I don't know whether there should be any other solution found because that's just getting ridiculous. I mean, it's just making it really dangerous for people to cross, across the crossing by Lidl's.
So we know that the market day gets busy. We know that the market company are constantly looking at what approach they can take to improve parking and improve access to the market. So it will keep getting better, but it's a popular event. It's a busy day in the town.
Maybe you need to think with having park and ride, maybe a better solution might be to have buses that actually go down on the circular route, pick people up on the route rather than car drivers driving to park and ride and picking up a bus. I don't know, that's just maybe
sure they are thinking of just those things. Okay, anybody else? Great, okay, in which case I'm going to introduce Bob Ashford, who's here, who is the chairman of Fair Frome, who's going to give us an update on what they're up to, where they are, which will lead us into a conversation we're going to have about well-being and the part that the town council plays in that.
Well,
thanks,
Toby. Whatever I try is if I know no one's being filmed. Being circulated is what I'm going to speak to. I haven't got an overhead slide or anything else, but so it's no beginning from you as it comes around. As the Mayor says, I'm the Chair of the Trustees of Fair Frome. We've now been going for almost 3 years, actually. And basically, we believe we deliver on the Frome Free Town Council key strategic priorities, well-being, which is on the agenda later, prosperity, empowerment, enabling others, and importantly, campaigning. Our main projects are running food banks, community dining events, fair food, volunteering and training opportunities. We campaign against inequality and other issues. We help coordinate local groups working with the homeless and the vulnerable. And we also contribute to other groups in local agendas, and we raise cash, lots of it. Many thanks to the people of Frome for that. Probably worth saying to start with, and I know the health and wellbeing report covers it as well, but Frome is, unfortunately, a very divided town economically. On the one hand, you know, there are new shops, there's lots of activity, there's the independent markets, Catherine Hill is thriving, and it would appear to anyone coming here that Frome is actually a thriving town, and I say in many ways it is. But beneath that veneer, there are many, many people in this town that are really struggling, and they're struggling to pay rent, they're struggling to find housing, they're struggling to put food on their plate, they're struggling to put furniture in their homes, and in many ways, they're unseen. But there are several organisations in this town that we help and we work with, like the CAB, the Roots, the YMCA, etc., Tony, who's over there, and other groups that actually work with this very vulnerable group. And one of the most important things I think we do is to actually help work with, coordinate and identify what the issues are in the town and try to deal with them practically, in terms of practical help. And this is one of the things that Fair Frome does. We don't just talk, we don't just campaign, we offer practical and hopefully useful help. But the coordination role is useful because, as I say, all these groups exist. And every 6 weeks, we meet and we talk together. And that is really invaluable. We also work with other organisations in the town, some of the more traditional ones, if you like the Carnival Club, the Rotary, the Lions, etc. And we try to make sure that everything we do as an organisation is sort of in synchronicity, if you like, with what they do as well. So we work very closely with them in terms of fundraising, activities, projects, etc. We also contribute to the town council panels and working groups as well, like the health and wellbeing panel and literacy, etc. But moving on to the food bank, this is sort of one of our kind of the flagship, if you like, of Fair Frome. And over the last 12 months, we've actually been sort of consolidating it now. We think it runs very smoothly, actually extremely smoothly. And not least to thank our sort of volunteers for the way that does run. But importantly, in terms of what I was saying earlier, there have been over 430 food parcels have been distributed between this January, last January, and the end of October this year, which equates to around 800 people undergoing crisis points in their lives. And this is in Frome, the population of what, 30,000? Food bank distribution has doubled over the last year. Take up of our food parcels, food top-ups, has doubled over the last year. And again, that's as a result of many of the things that we've discussed in the later report, but it's about the changes to the introduction of universal credit. It's about reductions and changes to welfare benefit, to disability benefits, to freeze on those, for instance. It's about Brexit and the impact on the euro. The prices, you know, are going higher, they're going to be higher. It's about OPEC and the rise in oil prices. There's a whole sort of, if you like, sort of, you know, storm of things which are impacting upon the cost of living for people in the town, for some people in the town. And that's having a really detrimental effect. I mean, we heard a couple of weeks ago that anyone signing on now for universal credit would have to wait until after Christmas before they receive any funding, anything. And what that means is those people, unless they have friends, family to support them, will have nothing. And the only recourse many of them have is to the food bank, which I think in 2016 is fairly shocking, actually. So the food bank is there, it runs really well, it runs again because of the generosity of people in the town who donate their food on a regular, weekly basis. We collect it, we distribute it through our partners, and it's people who are referred through those partners, the CAB, the YMCA, the Job Centre, medical practice, etc., that actually help us in terms of identifying who the people that really need those parcels are. Short term, it's not long term. We've also, I mean, just some other things we've done in terms of the food bank. The Harvest Festival this year was amazing. You know, every church in Rotterdam, most churches in the town, most schools in the town have a Harvest Festival. This year, they all contributed to Fair Food, which was brilliant, and the food bank, absolutely brilliant. What it also did, in some schools, was start a debate around poverty, around sharing, etc., which was also kind of a great spin-off of the food bank as well. People discuss these issues, children discuss these issues, to get to understand what it means to actually be in the seat or need a food bank. You've also done things like Polish and Eastern European population here, and we thought it was important to try to expand the demographics of people who actually receive food parcels, which we want to do again next year, because many elderly people don't access the food bank for all sorts of reasons, which is unfortunate. I can't believe there aren't elderly people in the town that need it. We've also, next year, we want to, as I say, widen the demographic of take-up. We also want to look at actually trying to find a longer-term premises, a longer-term solution for how we run the food bank as well. We would love it not to have volunteers working in freezing cold containers, you know, throughout the winter. It's not good. Not good for volunteers, not good for anyone to be in that kind of situation. And we'd also like to get closer to the people who use the food bank ourselves. The furniture bank, next year we are going to create a furniture bank in the town. You've probably read about it in the paper. And again, this sort of follows the basic principles of Fair Frome about real projects, real people making a real difference. And it makes sense to us that if we're putting food on people's plates, that we should also actually provide them with the plates and provide them with the table to eat it off and provide them with the chair to sit at the table. And again, you know, if you're lucky enough in the town and if you're all on a low income, and these aren't just unemployed people, I'm talking about working people here. But if you are in a situation where you're lucky enough to find social housing or private rent or whatever, when you go there, there's nothing there. You know, unless you've got, again, friends and family or somebody else to help you, you won't have any furniture, any carpet or anything else. And again, what we're looking to do, and we are going to do, very early in the new year, is to create a furniture bank. Similar to the food bank, whereby people donate furniture, we're going to upcycle it, working with Critchell School, working with others, we can repair it, upcycle it, recycle it, and then give it away to those people in need through referrals from our partners. It takes money, it takes energy, but we are absolutely committed to do it, and we will do it. Community dining, we've held 4 community dining events in the past year, attended by over 600 people. We've worked with all kinds of food, we've worked with big Christmas get-together. They really are great community events, actually. And again, we provide the food and other people come along, other organisations come along to support those. And a really superb community event in the town, ranging from quite small ones in some places to the one in the park and, of course, the big Christmas get-together. We started this year include the food, so we've run Fair Food, a weekly community, low-cost hot lunch at the Bridge Cafe, where Tony is, for 3 months, serving around 150 people. It's currently running and it's sponsored by the Southern Co-op Funeral Care at the moment. We're looking for more funding for that in the future, and from outside sponsors as well, but it works really well. And again, Tony and the Bridge Cafe work at the heart of the town in terms of people who are homeless, who are struggling, etc. in that area. And it's a very simple thing, food's provided, low cost, and alongside the food comes help with benefit advice, etc., etc. Works really well, and we want to continue. Volunteering, I'm trying to go as quick as I can, David. Volunteering, we've got around 30 active volunteers working at the food bank. Amazing people, absolutely amazing people, who I say are down there all year round, sorting, sifting, collecting. You know, they really are great. They help us with admin, with fundraising. So last weekend, I can't not say this, last weekend, the Frome Christmas Market and the Frome Extravaganza, you know, we, through our volunteers, through the generosity of people at Frome, donated over £3,000 to Fair Frome and the big Christmas Get Together, which was amazing, actually. You know, more than last year, and brilliant. It just helps us to continue what we want to do. It's really superb. Campaigning. So, you know, Fair Frome doesn't just deliver projects, we also can pay. And that's the right thing to do, because of what I said earlier, you know? Somebody needs to shout, somebody needs to make people aware of the difficulties that some people in the town are facing. That's right and proper, here and everywhere else. And that's not a Fair Fringe role. So, you know, with the things I talked about earlier, you know, we want everyone to be aware of that. We want everyone to know what's going on in the town and where they live, so that they can, if they wish, help and come alongside us and support us and help with the things we do. So, you know, over the last year we've continued the living wage campaign, which is right. You know, it's the right thing to do. To pay a living wage benefits everyone, employers, employees, us as taxpayers. Because then people are not reliant on the welfare benefits. It can take 6 or 8 weeks to come through if you find yourself unemployed, etc. So it's the right thing to do, and that's been, again, successful. We raise our voice, and it's up to other people then, if you like, in the longer term, to continue that. We are, you know, our local GPs present, I'm bound to say, you know, we also raise the optional surgery closure, which we do find, I'm bound to say, appealing, actually, the way the consultation was run, and also the fact that surgery was closed without a decision from NHS England, and it's still closed, and it's still, to my mind, there still hasn't been a decision from NHS England about that particular closure. Valuable resource, gone. And there's a real danger now to the pharmacy on Boxton as well, that may also play, which is really, I think, quite concerning. We also screened The Divide, the film, if you remember that, earlier in the year, and we had a panel and a debate about that, and that was a film about poverty and, as I mentioned earlier, the growing divide between those that have and those that haven't, both in the UK and in the USA as well. It was a good debate, lots of people turned up, and it was a good and interesting evening. We also, the ASDA campaign, if you remember that, earlier in the year, the ASDA, Leicester, decided that corporately they were going to stop having food bank collection points in all their stores across England and Wales, Scotland, province. And we found out about this in Peru and we raised a campaign locally. We said, this is right, you know, it's crazy, it's bad policy for you, it's bad for us, because we aren't getting the food that we need. And so we raised a campaign locally about that. It was then taken up nationally. And amazingly, and beautifully, ASDA then, if you like, decided against what they'd done, reinstated the food bank, park collection points, not just in Frome, but across the country. So a campaign which Fair Frome Star started locally, became national, with a brilliant result at the end of it, which is great. Next year, we're also, you know, we never stopped, we're also looking for where we're going to go, and next year we're thinking about, we are going to look at an access campaign in the town. And I know there have been other groups looking at that, you know, previously, but it sort of came to mind recently when I was talking to someone in a wheelchair and some other young mums with children about their access and their perceived lack of access to places in the town, which we all, me or I am, as able-bodied, sort of take for granted, actually. So we're going to look at that with other groups in the town to see if we can, again, you know, raise our voice, raise a debate about access in the town, not just for people in wheelchairs, but for people access in its widest sense. So young mothers in wheelchairs, people in wheelchairs, etc. And all that, you know, it's been a really busy year. Trustees, volunteers, and Wendy Miller-Williams, who can't be here tonight, our one part-time paid coordinator, without whom none of this would be possible. But it also, the success has also been about people in the town and the support they give. But last and not least would be the town council, because, you know, Fair Frome wouldn't have started without the town council, we wouldn't exist without the town council. And when I say the town council, I don't just mean, you know, officers and the cash, I mean councillors as well, who, you know, some of you were out last weekend collecting money, love the picture, and also other officers from the town council, so Chris, Peter, etc., everyone, Kate, that actually helps us with our work and provides, I say, not just the funding, and the practical support, but also, if you like, the space to do what we do, which I say, we wouldn't exist without that. And we look for, and are hoping for, and wish for, and will have, I'm sure, your future support over the next 12 months. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Well, thanks very much.